Good morning, everyone. On behalf of Sri Devrajaras Academy of Higher Education and Research, I extend a warm welcome to all of you for this webinar, which is the first in the series of webinars conducted by UCHP, that is University Center for Health Professions Education. UCHP webinars are aimed at empowering educators in addressing the challenges in educational practices in all situations. Today's webinar addresses the challenges faced by the faculty in terms of delivering the competency-based curriculum that we have currently been getting trained at for the last 2 years. UCHP has also launched the YouTube channel along with this webinar series on the occasion of National Education Day in the presence of Dr. Ved Prakash Mishra, with a goal to disseminate innovations and best practices in health professions educations to reach a wider audience. The inbuilt facility of YouTube Live will enable the audience to watch the webinar live and comment on the same too. I now request our director of UCHP, Dr. Vinita Shankar, to introduce the speaker for today's webinar, Dr. Thomas Chandler.
Good morning, everyone. I consider it a proud privilege to be introducing Professor Thomas Chacko, who was awarded an International Fellowship in Medical Education, IFME, in 2002, which he completed with distinction at the Department of Medical Education, UIC Chicago, and the two-year Educational Leadership Fellowship, the Famer Institute at Philadelphia, by the Foundation for Advancement of International Medical Education and Research, FAMER, and was subsequently invited to serve as a global faculty advisor for the FAMER Institute program in Philadelphia. Sir has been since the past 13 years, he's a director of the PhD FAMER Regional Institute that administers the two-year FAMER Institute Fellowship program for faculty in medical schools in the South Asia region. He was also the General Secretary General of World Federation of Medical Educators, Southeast Asian Regional Association for Medical Education, popularly known as CRAME, for 6 years, and is now the director of its Student Electives Exchange Program. And sir has been the president of the Academy of Health Professions Educators India during 2017. Sir is often invited to be a member of the WHO expert committees to recommend improvement in teaching of public health in the Southeast Asia region. Sir has also been invited to conduct tailor-made workshops for capacity building of health professionals and educators in several national and international conferences. His areas of interest in medical education include curriculum planning, program evaluation, competency-based and community-based medical education, and educational change management towards improving teaching in medical schools and improving global standards in medical education. We are extremely fortunate to have our mentor, Dr. Thomas Chacko, with us to deliver the first webinar of this series. Sir, we owe a lot to you for all the initiatives that we take in our parent institution. Thank you for being with us, sir. Over to you, sir.
So as the title says, overcoming the challenges, the competency-based medical education has been launched all over the country after changing the faculty concern, because it was correctly realized that faculty development is key to bring about the change. But having done that and having tasted with the 2019 batch of MBBS, our faculty in India have come across various challenges, and especially since we are all not in a very resource strong setting, we are all constrained by resources, and so this webinar tries to look into those constraints and the way out, so that we can go with a positive frame of mind and start picking up the threads. So way back in 2014, before the competency program-based medical education was to be launched, I had done a review of literature on what is this. Everybody was wanting to know what is this competency-based medical education. The thing was, there is plenty of literature, and it was fortunate for us in India to begin late. In fact, 30 years later than it was launched elsewhere. And so plenty of literature was available that could identify the challenges, and based on all that, this paper was published, and it gives good insights into the challenges for which we need to be ready. So the key challenge was to identify the elements of competence and learning for mastery and assessment of competence. And then the importance of preparing teachers, students, and including the institution, because we were on, neither the teachers nor the students nor the institution had any idea about what is this competency-based curriculum and what are the requirements. So I was talking about the paper, and the key elements are identifying the elements of competence, learning for mastery, which is a key concept in competency-based education, and naturally, assessment of the competence. And the importance of preparing teachers, the students, and including the institution. And it was also important to prepare the students because they are habituated in taking listening passively. What the teacher tells, they will listen. It's all spoon feeding. But in the competency-based medical education, the emphasis is on active learning and taking personal responsibility for the learning. So that was a new role for the student. They need to adopt more self-directed learning methods because they need to practice the specified competencies that they need to acquire. And for that, they should require this feedback on the progress made. So our role as teachers is to provide them with opportunities for practice of those skills and provide feedback on the progress made, whether they are achieving the targeted or benchmarked level of competencies, which we speak as knows how, shows how, and does. So we also, the student has to demonstrate, the onus is on the student to demonstrate development in competency and competency progression and document the evidence of competency progression, because we as teachers need to give feedback and as well as give them scores, which gets documented into their record book and the log book, and that serves the purpose. And it reassures both the teacher and the student that they are moving in the right direction, as well as it tells them where they are at present, so that they need to study accordingly and prepare and march towards competency progression. So what has already been done is curricular shift, the identification of competencies has been done by the MCI expert group. The benchmarking of competencies has also been done almost for the phase-wise milestones that have been listed, what needs to be completed by which phase, and then the assessment of competencies, and then overall assessment of the program and program evaluation, which will be required to be done as we go down the line. But we need to be knowledgeable about the overall assessment of the program, the MBBS program for each phase. Are we able to deliver what the students are expected to do? And if not, identify what are the problems. So since the topic of this webinar is competency acquisition in resource constraint settings and overcoming, it's important to overcome these challenges after identifying what are the constraints. And so I suggested to the organizers to include it in your registration form itself, what were the constraints you perceived in the competency acquisition. And so the vote was for overwhelmingly the COVID pandemic, which was the number one constraint which came in the way of the competencies. Then paucity of infrastructure, because the infrastructure required for competency-based medical education is slightly different from the predominantly knowledge-based curriculum that we were having. There is shortage of staff because for competency-based medical education, we need to put the students in an active state of mind and engage them in smaller groups. So for smaller groups, we need to have staff. And there are ways, of course, to overcome this shortage, but nevertheless, there is shortage of staff. Then, of course, the training was there by the Medical Council of India initiated, but it only orients them. It's called the basic course in medical, revised basic course, which orients them to the revision and the changes in the curriculum. But it doesn't prepare them for actually implementing the competency-based medical education. And so, rightly perceived as inadequate training, and then also perception of there is paucity of time and lack of enthusiasm in students. So it is important for us to understand the new CBME curriculum, and we are basically continuing in our discipline-based, teacher-centered mindset. And we need to move towards student and learner-centered, and that to outcomes. And the new curriculum has identified the expected outcomes, and but we now need to move from predominantly knowledge-based curriculum towards competency and transformative curriculum. And so the Indian curriculum is in transition. We are between information-based to transformative curriculum. So it has specified the graduate outcomes, what the Indian medical graduate should be able to do, but it continues to function and deliver through our own respective departments. There has not been a change in that framework. We still continue to work in silos. So we can say that the new curriculum is evolutionary, not revolutionary. There is no drastic change. Even in Western countries where the competency-based curriculum has been launched, an option or the in-between way is also available where students can opt. But here in India, we don't have this option. It's a hybrid one, building on the existing curriculum and facilities. And we are moving towards training for specified, identified competencies. So we can call the curriculum as competency-driven. So the curriculum is driven by the identified competencies, and each of those identified competencies, certain knowledge bases to be acquired. So outcome competencies have been already documented as the Indian medical graduate goals, roles, and the ATCOM graduate attributes, what the graduate should exhibit, the characteristics are all new and focused and covered, attempted to be delivered through the ATCOM module. Larger number of proportion of integration has been included in the new curriculum, rightly so, because we are still in the hybrid phase department, and so, and there was shortage of time, and so integration was the solution. Still, it is teacher-driven, and the CISP or the Curriculum Implementation Support Program, which was launched by the Medical Council and the NMC and still there, orients them to the curriculum outcome competencies which have been listed in the curriculum document. And the CISP group work requires the participants to identify and convert the SLOs into specific, the outcome competencies to SLOs and to deliver the specific learning objectives for a competency, the methods and the assessment. So because the curriculum is competency driven and there is a shortage of time, and we want the students to become self-directed lifelong learners, elements of self-directed learning is also included to take care of the shortened time that is available. So basic thing and premise we should understand is it focuses on building the knowledge base. The competency builds with knowledge. So the erstwhile basic sciences departments, pre and para, provides the knowledge base, knows how and shows how, and then some skills that are required for the Indian medical graduate. So there is a competent, definite competency progression as the student moves as a cohort from first year to the final year. And so that is easy to understand, but focus is on the competencies. And then assessment paradigm, there is a shift. We teachers were sitting in judgment and on the student performance, and mostly used to the role of giving judgment or pass-fail decisions. But now the new assessment focus is on learning. So we assess the student performance, and based on the student performance, we identify and give feedback on the areas which require to be improved by the learner. And communicating that to the learner is a way of learning. And so it is called assessment for learning. And then that goes on till the whole targeted competency progression is achieved. So the emphasis is on given our role as a teacher is to give feedback. And then assessment of learning, of course, at the end of each unit or year, the assessment of learning happens, which includes the university exam, which is a high stakes exam, which delivers pass-fail decisions. And certifies, the new curriculum also requires certain skills and competencies to be certified. And so there is an element of endpoint where the faculty will certify whether they are able to do, for example, cardiopulmonary resuscitation and things like that. Basic skills expected of the medical graduate. And then in the new competency-based education, it's the documentation of competency progression is more emphasized. We are used to the record book, which tells what learning experience the student has had during the practical hour or the clinical posting or their observation. But here, a kind of observation plus for them to show how that needs to be documented, and the feedback that we gave needs to be documented, and the progression that they have achieved needs to be documented. So all that goes into the record or the portfolio, where it is the record together with the scores of the performance and competency progression. And we also have the log book, which is a kind of a summary of the learning progression and in their competency acquisition. So when I said our curriculum, the changes in India are part of the global shift in the curriculum from teacher-centered to student-centered, from informative to formative. Ultimately, the ultimate goal is to move towards transformative, where our medical graduates not only become professionals and competent, but also they become effective change agents. That's the ultimate goal. But if we look at the graduate competencies of an Indian medical graduate, we say leader and change agent. Leadership requires skills for transformation. And so those skills are required and it's a competency. And so it doesn't happen by itself. We have to create the learning environment and the opportunity. So it's a hybrid curriculum currently. It is between informative and transformative. So it's a hybrid one. It's time bound, whereas a pure competency-based curriculum is supposed to not be constrained by time. The program runs till the student achieves competency. And that is why the new curriculum, which decided that we cannot expand the time that is available. We have to deliver within the time that is available. And so the milestones to be achieved in each phase of the MBBS program has been identified. And that helps the student progress from a knowledge base to skills and competencies. This concept of competency-based curriculum is nothing new. Way back in 1978, WHO brought out the public health paper on competency-based curriculum development in medical education. So focus is on training and learning for mastery. The graduate should be able to master the skills and be ready for the job. So the stages, as teachers, we have to be aware as facilitators of the learning of the students that the student is not aware of a particular skill. By making them aware, we move them from unconscious incompetent to consciously incompetent. The student becomes aware of the skill or the level or the gap in their competency, and that motivates them to consciously engage in learning and acquiring the skill to the desired level of competence. And so the desired level, everything has to be communicated well to the learner. So one of the failures on our part is we are not communicating to the students what is the target level to be achieved within the available frame of time. And so once that is communicated, then they can acquire on their own with our help and guidance, of course. The skills to be mastered have to be prioritized, identified by the respective departments. So we have to take them through the various frameworks. We teachers need to be familiar with that. The DOAP practicals, demonstrate, observe, assist, perform, and all that has been already mentioned in the CISP document. And it's the educational basis is also identified well, and the learning framework is there, and we need to take. We should be conscious of these phases so that we will give a chance to the student to acquire them. Whether directly or even in the virtual mode, knowledge of these progressions and the mechanism of practice by the student helps them progress in their competency acquisition So the key thing is the new competency-based medical education is to make them job ready for the MBBS graduate should be able to function as a basic doctor at the primary care level or at the ambulatory setting. So the problem or the shift towards CBME was initiated because our students were not job ready. They were knowledgeable, but not competent to do simple skills. And even the patients started not trusting the MBBS graduate. They all went to the postgraduates because the training did not train them about the common skills. So knowledge alone is not enough. So ensuring mastery, learning of for mastery of the competencies is the key, and we have to start. And this process goes on throughout the MBBS phase and even after qualification. And so these are the milestones when you are mostly converting a novice to an advanced beginner. The MBBS student is taken up to the advanced beginner, and then they further sharpen skills during the first year PG and third year PG, and by that time they become proficient, and then they qualify, and then they need to continue to engage in continuing professional development, deliberate practice. Otherwise, the skills started to decline. So deliberate practice and getting feedback, self-assessment, gap assessment, all that continues as a learning. So that is an additional advantage of the new CBME curriculum, which plants the self-directed learning and competency improvement methodology into the UG curriculum itself, and it becomes a habit so that it continues lifelong, and a trained professional, a qualified professional continues or is expected to continue to become competent, continue to be competent using these. So growth of competence over time is there, and it is important that we recognize this. Coming back to our current curriculum, the Indian medical graduate goals, roles, and all that integration is there. All that has been, I think, explained. And coming back to what you have expressed in your registration, what is it that is inadequate or the constraint which prevents, you have rightly identified understanding the CBME itself, not much understood and is a constraint. Then currently online teaching, many of us were trained in the traditional way. We are not familiar with online teaching, and so there is a need and for online teaching, and that's a constraint. It prevents many of our veteran teachers, excellent teachers, from delivering their capabilities because they are not savvy or familiar with the online teaching modalities. Then we are not familiar with training modules, development of those modules in a systematic way, lesson planning, logbook, COVID-induced hindrance to hands-on skills. So we are, many of the us teachers are simply overwhelmed because so far the students were with us and now they are not with us. And how we are used to imparting clinical skills directly, and now with them not being present, it becomes a challenge, and they are overwhelmed and they need to be trained to overcome this. Then the lack of motivation. among administration as well as the faculty. So that this has been expressed by you at the time of registration. And also you have observed that many faculty in your institution are resistant to change. So that's a hindrance, and that perhaps resistance to change and can be overcome by training them. That's the assumption. So there is a need for an in-house faculty development program. Medical Council has set the ball rolling, but every medical college has a MEU department where the MEU core members have undergone training, further training in medical education. So they will be in a better position to design the training that is need-based, that addresses the need of the faculty within their own institution. So workshops, online teaching is an important need. So the MEU could conduct workshops or flip classroom, which is a blended learning method of prior to class reading, self-reading by the faculty, and then they deliver or meet face-to-face and discuss the important things for a better understanding. So unless the faculty undergo the flipped classroom experience, they will not be equipped for designing a flipped classroom kind of method for the student. And so it is an important thing. Creating self-directed learning modules build on the learning gap of the learner. So the first step in self-directed learning is to identify where are the students now, what is their current level now, and make the student aware of the gaps so that they are then motivated to do self-directed learning under supervision of the faculty. The new role of the teacher is also towards simulated case scenarios, even without the COVID epidemic, even in the Western developed countries, the patients are aware of their rights and they won't allow themselves to be subjected to learning by the students, multiple students at the same time. And so prior preparation using simulated scenarios and learning, simulation-based learning, prepares them to be able to learn from the patients lesser time, and they become more efficient in their learning, so that patient safety and patient distress from the learning becomes reduced. So online teaching of knows and shows level of competence is possible, and it needs to be encouraged and scaled up. We have already been doing that successfully, I hope, and I'm sure. And then we, even after COVID, this should continue. So the knowledge base of knows how and shows how can be delivered through online. And after the students come back, the focus is on to verify whether the student is able to perform what the student has virtually learned through videos, by seeing, by demonstration, by practicing role play and all that. After the student comes back on site, our role will be to verify whether they are able to do, and then we can certify that they are able to show and they are able to do. So for all this, and to overcome the resistance and motivation and to support the faculty within an institution, the knowledge and the innovations that happen within the institution in isolation. Only few people do innovative things. But when that is shared within the faculty group via either WhatsApp or email groups, then it opens up, it creates interest in the rest of the faculty, and the islands of excellence becomes oceans of excellence, and it leads towards institutional excellence. Many of you have identified inadequate staff as one of the constraints, many of the faculty being busy or taken away for COVID frontline work, so that they are not available. And even although skills lab that has been made mandatory, everything may not be available and everything cannot be learned in the skills lab alone. Then small group discussion, the infrastructure is not available, but the MCIN and MC has come up with alternate ways and spaces to conduct small group discussion. Then currently we have this problem of no cases being there that are appropriate for MBBS students. So even if the student comes back from the COVID we faculty are faced with the situation in our inpatient and outpatient of seeing cases that are not appropriate for the MBBS. And also it exposes the students to risks. And so it's a constraint. So these are some of the constraints, and the solutions could be in terms of capacity building and of teachers in online teaching, as well as producing self-directed learning modules to build the knowledge base. And then after that, they can use these various methods during the online learning phase to overcome some of these constraints of inadequate staff and skills labs, and ensuring that the students learn and they are exposed to the various skills through all these methods that are listed. And the key is to go online before with the knowledge, and post COVID practice the skill that is there. So the remaining time that is available, as soon as they join, that entire time available is repackaged for the practice of the skills. Another important constraint that you have rightly identified is lack of motivation amongst the administration and faculty, and they are all distracted by the current epidemic, and they are not in the mood. They are in the shock stage. Slowly we are coming out of it, and some are simply resistant to change. They don't want to change. And so the solutions is to have a look at the model of motivation, the self-directed determination theory, which takes us to the phase of amotivation to motivation. So extrinsic motivation means motivation of the faculty from outside. And ideally, we should have encourage do things that will make the faculty internally motivated. Amongst the examples of extrinsic motivation is for the MEU and the administration to cite the requirements and the recommendations of MCIN so that they will come for inspection. And then the another would be we have to emphasize that unless we deliver and produce a graduate with the required competencies and skills and outcomes, the college ranking will fall. And when the college ranking falls, the parents may choose to send their students elsewhere to better performing colleges. And so it is in the interest of the faculty to make sure that we produce graduates that are better than other institutions. Another point of leverage could be the students, especially we are all required to have students union and parent-teacher association and all those things. We could use feedback from them about the learning of the students, and very interesting observations come from the feedback, and this feedback can be shared with the faculty to motivate them to perform better. It clarifies the expectations of the from the faculty, and so it is useful to get feedback and use it to motivate the students. It's an example of extrinsic motivation, and there could be institutional pressures. Institutions may not be providing us with infrastructure, so we have to have a dialogue with our administrators and tell them that unless we have the environment which is conducive to competency development and outcomes, then in future the students may not prefer to get admitted to our institution. And so it is a pressure on the institution, and in turn the institution will have exert extrinsic pressure and motivation on the teachers by announcing rewards and incentives to good high performance teachers with high performance and good performance, and receiving good feedback from the students and things like that. So that way we will have a larger number of faculty who are motivated. Then resistance to change is a very age-old phenomenon, and it is not uncommon. So intrinsic motivation through incentives and reward and all that, those things will work. And one of the factors or arms in the intrinsic motivation is autonomy, the perception of having choice of learning tasks. So those faculty who are feeling that they don't have, they are not motivated and not having this feeling of a choice in learning tasks, then they are like the pistachios that we have. Some of them are open to ideas, they are open to change, but some of them are closed. And so we need to ignore for the time being the closed ones and use the open pistachios, those who are open and receptive and motivated. Let them be the exemplars, and they will demonstrate competence in the new competency-based education, how they are able to implement, and that will be an exemplar for the closed faculty who are resistant to change. And over a period of time, they will also open up. So start with the low-hanging fruits, and that will help enlarge the number of faculty who are motivated and less resistant to change, so that the larger body of faculty fall in line with the new curriculum, and they are able to focus on their abilities rather than on their abilities or skills that they don't have. And so they will also, over a period of time, take interest in improving themselves and their own capabilities. So we need to build a community of practice, share little successes that each one of us has. The innovators, the open pistachios, the exemplars, they need to share what they have achieved, the innovations that they have tried out and succeeded. it is a good thing to for the leadership in the organization to encourage those who have been successful with some even small innovations, innovative ways of teaching to overcome the challenges, to share what works in spite of all the constraints. So when our fellow faculty are able to share, and the enthusiasm, the excitement that they show when they share is infectious, and it will open up the closed pistachios and add flavor to the program that is going on within the organization. Managing change is mostly on focusing on people. And so the MEUs, the medical educators, the leaders need to focus on the skills. From the current state, where are we, to the future state. So the vision and the outcome competencies that we expect of our students, and what is it that we are doing now and we need to do so that the vision of a competent Indian medical graduate is achieved. And so that change process takes time. Change management is about supporting people through the transition. It's not a blame game. So if they are faltering, then it is our responsibility to support them, show them examples, tangible examples, tangible models of what work, so that they get the confidence and move forward. So in any organization, for leading change, there are 8 steps to transforming your organization. We need to establish a sense of urgency. We can send tell about the medical council or the NMC and the need to be very urgent in our action for change. We need to form groups. We have to communicate the vision. We have to empower others by building their capacity for the things that they are required to do. And then we need to plan for the change, creating short-term wins, and then consolidating the improvements and produce more change, and institutionalizing new approaches. So that is what I was telling about the community of practice and sharing good practices, sharing of small successes, the working models, so that a larger number of faculty within the institution become familiar with little things that they can do, and they start doing, and the change happens. Then you have rightly identified the students. Students come into the MBBS program with a different mindset. Mostly it is on memory recall and cramming, and the system that they have been used to is the teacher-centered, teacher-driven one, knowledge-focused. And so suddenly, when we expose them to the competency-based curriculum, they start wondering what it is. And especially when we are in the online mode, there is cut off from reality, there is shortened time, and compounded with that, there is delayed admissions. So disinterest, shortened time, delayed administration. And so in the didactic, if we have to repeat our didactic direct lectures in the online mode, at least in the classroom, your physical presence is there. But if we repeat the same process online, then they can switch off their cameras and they can sleep. So it is important that we design methodology to engage them, engaging the students in active learning. So activities, small activities online, and giving them assignments Going through the assignments and giving feedback, of course, all these take time and energy on our part, but the disinterested students the shortened time, all these can be taken care of by self-directed learning, more use of flipped classroom assignments, and giving them guided learning modules. So we need to move from the traditional method of lecturing to engaging the learner in the online platform. And so for this, we need to conduct hands-on training for our faculty in this new paradigm of teaching and learning. And so both teachers and students will benefit. Another important thing that we must be able to do is to diagnose the learner, to find out what level is the student. Is the student is in the dependent stage? Then our role will be as a coach. If they are interested, or if we, after we create interest in them, our role becomes that of a motivator and a guide. And then after they get involved in the learning process, then we are there as a facilitator of their learning. So getting them involved in learning and acquiring skills and competencies, and our role as a facilitator. So all that we have to identify which stage our students are in, and then push them into the higher stage so that then they become self-directed. Most of our professionals, after qualification, they become self-directed learners. But that habit of self-directed learning must be initiated during the MBBS time itself. So we need to diagnose the learner, and based on that, tailor our teaching style to the diagnosis we have made of the learner. Then we are faced with all the new ways of competency-based education assessment issues, on the new ways in which CBME is to be assessed, online assessment, whether they will cheat, ways to overcome these challenges. So formative versus summative, the mindset in the mind of the student teacher has to change. And we have to realize that in competency-based medical education, our primary area is to help them to learn. That's a, we are assessing them so that they get idea about their current status in their competency progression and what more needs to be learned. What are the areas that they need to learn on their own or with assistance? Giving feedback on the performance is the way to do that. Competency assessment will require a specialized checklist where we break down the skill, deconstruct the skill into smaller steps, which they can practice, the students can practice, and we can create situations and scenarios where those steps the students go through and we assess them. And then capture that in the logbook. The logbook itself will serve as a tool to facilitate their assessment. So we have to capture and put scores in the logbook or in the record or their portfolio so that the students become motivated for self-learning and improvement. There are various ways in which we can prevent cheating by students. One way is to ask applied questions, not simply allow them to copy paste or to ask answers from each other. There are different ways, and within institutions, some of you would have discovered, and you can share how you are able to overcome the cheating by students. And the skill of giving online feedback is also important, and most institutions have a learning management system which gives systematic process to the learning and giving feedback and the performance assessment. And so an answer to overcome all these issues of assessment is in-house faculty development workshop specific to all these skills, dedicated to each specific obstacle that you feel is preventing our teachers and students from learning. And so these forming a communities of practice within the organization is very important, so that the faculty feel free and uninhibited in asking for help, and fellow faculty feel happy to come up with suggestions, so that we, the community of teachers within the institution, we improve. So these are things that we are familiar with, and we need to tailor our assessment to the new paradigm of the CBME. So the logbook must be seen in that context, and design of logbook, the MCA or NMC has given a basic framework, but the philosophy behind that we have to understand, so that it becomes, the logbook as a document should become clear for the student. The student must, on seeing the logbook, get a clarified expectation, clear expectation of what level they need to reach. And that should be reflected in the logbook, so that their competency progression becomes obvious, and it will motivate them to seek your feedback and guidance. So there are, of course, challenges due to COVID, and we have to take the students from the lower level to the higher level, from nose to knows how to shows how to does. So that is the gradual phase of competency development across the phases of MBBS. And so we need to realize what is our role within our department, to what level and competency we must take our students to. And at the same time, being conscious that the student is to reach a certain targeted level by the time of their graduation. So understanding this will make it clear to us teachers and to the students, so that the learning is better. The development of the knowledge component could start early and focus on assessment as well as learning exercises that targets the know-how, and then later from second MBBS onwards, it is shows how and does. So performance of competence, so during clinical years. This is to share one of the things that were successful in our institution during the COVID time. We had all the resource constraints, including the students had gone home even without taking the books. So we tried out the Facebook Live for clinical teaching. So the recording of the clinical rounds is telecast using the Facebook, which is a special Facebook channel. It's an initiative of the Students Academic Forum, and it is a close group. Only students and faculty can see. It's not available for the open general public. So the advantages are, it is easy to create. There is privacy because it's a close group. Recording device, because limited memory is there in the mobile phones that the students have access to. But if it is connected to the Facebook, then that recording device memory is not a handicap. So all students need to have Facebook. I'm sure most of them have now. There is somebody has to do the recording. And so some students need to stay back. And so it's a student initiative. It is sustainable. Something which can be replicated. And senior students can mentor the junior students. And this innovation that we tried is easy to replicate, and other institutions can replicate and even go beyond. What we could have done better was to provide more ready-made YouTube videos, encourage them to do a role play, and then we give feedback on their performance and allow them and encourage them to do practice on the negative points that we have pointed out in their performance on the video. And all this is possible, and we can create our own videos, link it to our learning management system and student management system so that the learning is documented into the system for everybody to see and monitor. We need to develop our faculty, their capability for all these. Without faculty being their capacity being up to scratch, all the innovations will not work. Also, the faculty should be able to capture teachable moments in their OP settings or inpatient settings, which could be video, and especially short video versions. And then also, if you have access to simulation lab, those things the students can do hands-on, or somebody could demonstrate, whereas the rest of the students learn by observation. New role of the teacher is as a facilitator. Teacher as a planner of the curriculum, because the MCA document has given general competencies, how to convert them into SLOs and how to create a learning environment, how it will be delivered, how it will be assessed. All that needs to be planned by teachers, by us. Teachers are as managers of instructional design, as performance assessors, teachers as evaluators. So we are used to a narrow band of role as a teacher, as an information provider. Way back in 2000, Hardin published the 12 roles of a teacher. And so we have to expand our capabilities beyond our role as an information provider to resource developer, planner, assessor, facilitator, and role model. And by deliberately planning and delivering on these roles, many of the so-called shortages of faculty can be overcome. And for that faculty development on these roles, we need to develop and deliver in-house faculty development programs. Our teachers are not familiar with self-directed learning modules and online teaching learning modules, how to create. So there needs to be a faculty development program for that. How to prepare for online, how to do you teach decisions like synchronous teaching, live lectures online, more suitable for the PGs, but asynchronous, work at their own pace, even for faculty, asynchronous learning by faculty and participation in faculty development programs is possible. We need to focus rather than on the knowledge component, how will we engage the student and the learner in self-directed learning and through discussion to reach higher cognitive domains and bring about change in attitudes. Use of email or WhatsApp, and designing ways to assess the learning through online learning, assignments, and giving feedback is an important thing. So these are some of the tips for online teaching. Learning management system is important. Course material need to be created. Due dates have to be communicated because it's asynchronous learning. Organize the course material into modules, and within modules, identify the portions that the students have to learn on their own and what they have to discuss and deliberate and apply their learning on, and the assignments that they submit should demonstrate that learning has taken place. So prioritize student communication and collaboration. Having clear office hours so students know where and when to get help and when while working remotely. So these are some of the tips for online teaching. I think we will learn more from questions that you are going to ask. Thank you.
Sir, thank you so much. The session has been really very informative. We have got a few questions, but I think what we'll do now is we'll ask the participants to raise their hands and in this, and then we can have a few questions that way.
Sure.
Prabha, you can go ahead, I'll unmute.
Yes, good morning, sir.
Yes, Prabha.
Sir, so it's a nice session. It was very interesting, and it's nice to hear about CDME. And sir, you very nicely spoke about the pistachio, the open ones, closed, and the half closed. So actually, we are facing that situation. So is it okay to divide students based on that and give extra activities to those who are more open, and either ignore or what to do about the others who are completely closed? How to manage those students?
Yeah. Overburdening those who are open may discourage them. So okay. Identify, if you are the head of department and you know certain people are close, then give them what they are able to do. So they could be prodded to produce a self-directed learning module. And those who are able to do online teaching, those who are open, they can do that. And when the students start appreciating the good work that those who are open to adopting the new methodologies, soon the word will reach the closed teachers and they will slowly open up. Anything that is harsh and seen as punitive will not work. So it is good to be patient, allow time, and use the students to leverage and bring about the change. And of course, over time, the closed ones will open up, and the institution has to announce incentives and recognitions. The institution could recognize high performers, and through recognition, will make the closed ones to also attempt at greater participation.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Sandhya?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, am I audible? Sir, it was a very nice presentation. My doubt is, sir, the poor performers often require more attention, as we all know. And how to assign attention to these poor performers or those who require more repetitions and things like that. We tend to kind of relegate them to, say, an SR or a postgraduate. I feel that is somehow not right. And these are the people who require more attention. But we are in a dilemma whether to invest in more time on these people or to give attention to the high, fast learner and an advanced learner. So what is your experience and what is your you know, advice to me in this confusion, sir?
Yeah, this labeling them as low performers itself is a stigma which we should avoid. Now the new competency-based curriculum will prevent the number of low, so-called low performers considerably, because now the focus is on acquiring competencies. And for competencies to be acquired, when we design our curriculum, the time that we are giving for them to practice and give feedback, and it is getting entered into their logbook, and they have to demonstrate that they are going to show improvement in their performance. All that becomes obvious, and so our curriculum should be so redesigned so that even the so-called slow learners also can catch up. You mentioned assigning them to SRs and things like that. That's fine. They should not feel singled out. The entire, of course, those who learn quickly, you can appreciate them. Another possibility could be they can be the friend or a mentor or a co-mentor to the batchmate and help them, and that will give them a better sense of satisfaction. And basically, competency-based medical education, a lot of self-learning is encouraged. So the low performers, once we make it clear to them what is their target level that they need to achieve and what is the limitation in time, I'm sure they will come up to the expected level.
Dr. Prasad.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Dr. Prasad, the registrar of the academy. A very excellent talk, sir.
Thank you.
On a very large topic, a comprehensive talk given starting from the initiation till the end of the CBME that we are talking of, competency-based medical education, sir. Being a part of the administrators group, which takes the majority of the brunt of bringing the change. My issue or the issue that I'm seeing here is, sir, that though it is a competency framework, and because the crux of the change from the old to the present curriculum is assessment, sir.
Right.
And if we don't use the same assessments or give the importance of these assessments in the summative exams, which are still aligned to the old type of assessments, the discouragement happens there, sir, to both the learner as well as the teacher. The major discouragement comes there because at the end of the day, we are the majority of the decision is being done from the summative assessments, which are actually not looking at competency attainment or performance assessments. So that is one issue which probably as a I don't know how to address that, and that creates a lot of hindrance in the faculty getting tuned to or accepting the change, sir. So how to address this?
Yeah, the competency-based medical education is not about only the summative examination. It has encouraged various competencies to be acquired, and the concept of portfolio is there. If our previous, at the time of our curriculum planning for a particular department, we have to map out the curriculum and identify the skills that need to be performed by the students. There is a wider sampling of their performance testing that happens during the course, and that the marks obtained during the competency progression, if it is recorded in the record book or the portfolio or the logbook, then it is not required to test all the competencies in the final university examination. What is done in Western countries is the student comes with the portfolio of the various competencies, and in the summative or the university exam, the external examiner also examines what is there in the university pattern exam, but also has a viva on the portfolio. So the external examiner goes through the portfolio and the scores obtained and the competencies obtained, progression in the portfolio or the logbook, and then asks specific questions and satisfies himself or herself about the level of expected competency or not. So it is a better and a stronger and a more valid assessment method when we combine summative with the portfolio. And so there is a wider sampling of what is assessed, and the validity also increases because it is a series of assessment on a particular competency, not a snapshot assessment by chance for a case that comes up during the university exam. I think CBME system is a better system than our traditional older system.
Correct, sir. Thank you for that answer, sir. My only this one is from the regulator side, that link that you have very nicely explained has not been established in the document. In the summative assessment, that link, what you are talking of, portfolio or the logbook to be given an importance and the externals to come and review, that is not clearly established. Gap which we will have to address.
Yeah, that we could emphasize. Suppose if you are a nodal center organizing these workshops, you could mention that. Or within in-house workshop, you can mention that. And since like you are the university, you could include that in your university pattern and make it clear. Because from assessment point of view, that makes better sense.
Thank you, sir.
Manoj Patki.
Good morning, sir. Very lucid presentation. I am a community medicine associate professor at Durham Medical College in Mizoram, and I'm also the MU coordinator.
Very good.
And currently pursuing ACME. Continuing with Mr. Prasad's question only, I think what is boiling this CBME moving towards programmatic assessment.
Yeah.
So, sir, I would like to get your views on what are the strengths, weakness, or opportunities, threats you see in this, because we are moving into that in a resource constraint, as we are saying, but what are the opportunities or strengths we can see in long run?
Yeah, you have spoken like a PSM man, SWOT analysis and things like that. Okay. We have to think it as a opportunity, because from the previous curriculum where it was mainly focusing on knowledge and recall, now this new curriculum aims at ensuring that the competency outcomes of an Indian medical graduate as a clinician, as a holistic care provider, and all those things that are written down in the goals, roles, and all those things. The curriculum addresses that, and assessment should be linked to that. Over a period of time, that has to be attained. So within, since you are an MEU coordinator and undergoing ACME program, programmic assessments, the system assessment, blueprinting of the whole program within the organization, within the university, all that exercises need to be gone through. It will happen and more clarity will emerge.
Sir, we had a few questions that came up to us. One thing is regarding the small group sizes. Like, for example, we have lesser faculty and we cannot have 1:10 ratio. So how will we ensure that? And second question is regarding whether the same thing will be applicable for CBME PGs, because NMC is particular only about UG. And the third one is how do we enhance student interest in online classes?
Yeah, so the first one was regarding small group.
Yeah,
small size is a kind of a constraint, but we have to design the activity in such a way that the teachers need not be subject experts. They should be trained as facilitators of the process. So we have to produce the guidelines. We have to be clear about what are the objectives to be achieved. What are the resources that the students could refer to? And then they are in groups. The facilitator could move from one group to another. They need not be rooted to one group. Of course, through online mode, they will be in breakout rooms and all those things. And then even one or two faculty could be enough to go back and forth. So it is possible. Then certain formats of small groups like pyramiding, snowballing, and all those things will make sure that the learning that happens within the group, like we have, we could start with the pair share and then it goes into the entire group of smaller group, and then the smaller groups present to the larger group. So that cascading, that format, if we adopt, even a single facilitator or faculty could manage. And so it's not necessary that for everything we should have. Of course, for demonstration in small groups, we will need support faculty to observe and give feedback and things like that. Or if there are not enough, then we could ask one of the students to record the video if it is a particular skill. And those videos can be then shown to the entire class. And then we can ask them, use the checklist, look out what are the things that are happening well, that are not happening, in the areas for improvement. And so we can have innovative ways in which once we know the fundamental or the framework, then innovation or our imagination is the only constraint. So we should not be bogged down by the group size and faculty not being there. You think of ways in which we can overcome that. There are lots.
Yeah, as one participant rightly put it, the cafeteria approach can be.
Yeah.
Yes. So the next one is the CBME for PGs. Like they want to know if at all there is any update for that too.
Mostly, see, for PGs, it is CBME only. Only it is not labeled like that. We need to structure the curriculum. Most of us are heads of departments and things like that. Within our own curriculum for PG, we could identify what competencies they should be able to demonstrate, identify them. And create learning opportunities, self-directed learning, And then our role as a facilitator will be to verify whether they have reached those levels of competencies. So exposing them to the methodology of competency progression and learning and benchmarking, all that is the hard work that teachers need to do. And then it becomes easy for the PGs to follow the scheme.
Yes, sir. The last question, sir, making online classes interesting in this competency delivery mode.
Yeah, can you repeat?
Making online classes interesting during competency delivery.
Yeah, online classes should not be lecture based all the time. It should be also giving them opportunity. Give them a task. Students could do a video of themselves. Now, this is an Instagram age and generation. No? The small clippings, the videos, the youngsters, they are all able to create their own videos. So any competency can be broken down into smaller components. And we can show them a demonstration video and that seeing that they can do role play with somebody in there within their family or in the within their group. And then that role play video can be shared and you can provide them feedback. Or their peers can themselves use the checklist. And so not only the person who is demonstrating the skill becomes aware of the steps and their level that they have reached, but the peers also become familiar about the steps through the checklist and what is the expectation.
Thank you so much, sir. Thanks a lot for the useful session wherein I think most of us got an idea as to how exactly we can go about doing this. Theoretically, we have been experiencing, sir, but practically, thanks for the suggestions. And we would like to have many more deliberations from your side, sir. Thank you so much. And I thank all the participants for registering. And in fact, we have registrations from around 150 colleges all over India and some from outside India. And so the dissemination has a wider reach and we can share experiences and best practices. Thank you, Dr. Thomas, sir. Thank you so much. And I thank all the participants for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir.